Sir Jonathan Antoine rose to fame when he and former singing partner Charlotte Giaconelli came second in the finals of Britain's Got Talent. That was way back in 2012. And he was on the show last year with his debut solo CD, Tenore, after appearing in the iTunes Festival alongside Pavarotti. He also appeared at the Autumn Proms and performed at the Muhammad Ali Celebrity Fight Night in Arizona earlier this year, receiving a standing ovation. He's about to embark on a UK tour, and I'm delighted to welcome him back to the studio this afternoon.
Hey, hello.
Good to see you, mate. How you doing?
It's great to be back, and I'm feeling great. How are you?
I'm good, thanks, mate. Yeah, we've had a refurb since you last came in, especially for you. We said, Jonathan's coming in, we better hurry this up.
Well.
Getting half decent now.
I expect nothing less.
Quite right, too. No, lovely to see you. And first of all, congratulations on the album, because last time you were in, it was just about to be released. Nerves were there, obviously, because your big album. At number one on the classical music charts.
Like I've said, I could not be happier with the way that it all came out. I made something I was super proud of, and then people really, really liked it. What more is there to this whole music thing than that, really?
Yeah, and that must have been quite a roller coaster ride for you, because, you know, releasing that CD was very, very important to you, wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it was... I'd just come out of the duo, and it was kind of me establishing myself for the very, very first time as me. And I can only just say thank you so much to everyone who embraced that and embraced the image and the music. And yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah. Well, your passion shines through very much in those tracks. And, you know, we heard some last time, and we'll hear something again in a second or two. But let's just talk a little bit about since then, because the things that you've done and the places that you've been, I mean, I just sort of skimmed over a few bits and bobs there. but what have you been up to most recently that you can tell us about?
I was recently at Rochester Cathedral. I'm terrible at names, but I did a gig there, and that was just spectacular. It was an outdoor festival type deal, and I've not done a lot of those kind of things, and it's always fun to get that kind of experience under your belt, and people are always just so up for it at festivals. Apart from that, I mean, I've really, really been gearing up to this tour.
Yeah.
This whole year has been in a lot of preparation and a lot of hard work focusing on what's coming next, which is this tour, which starts in November and ends at the very end thereof. And it's going to be all over the UK. I'm just so excited, and yeah, it's, as I said, it's been a lot of preparation up to that.
How do you prepare for a tour? Because I would imagine that you hear a lot from musicians that come on the show, and they'll say, I worried so much, I made myself ill just before I started.
Yeah.
And I suppose you've got to take it steady and relax and just take it in your stride, really, don't you?
Yeah, I mean, I've definitely had experiences very much like that, where prior to a show I've been so nervous, so full of anxiety that it does make you sick. But the way to prepare for any eventuality is to just relax overall. You've got to take a step back from everything and just realize that people are there for you, people are there to hear you, and people are there to enjoy themselves. And if you don't enjoy yourself, then other people can't really do that.
Yeah.
So preparing for tour has just been a lot of rehearsing the new repertoire. And yeah, that makes up the bulk of it. It's a hefty job, but aside from that, it's trying to relax as much as possible.
Yeah,
because if you get yourself all twisted up in a knot over what people are going to think, the repertoire you're doing, the lyrics, if you get too focused on it, you lose the actual performance and the fun of it, which is kind of what it's all about.
Yeah, absolutely. And how do you relax? I noticed that, I mean, when I was chatting to you earlier on in reception, you had the headphones on. I'm getting the impression that you love your music, so you actually relax by listening to music.
Yeah, it's quite weird. I guess a lot of musicians would tend to try and move away from music as a whole, but I like to listen to other people's music to help me relax. I mean, this year's been great for all kinds of different artists, and I've been listening to a lot of stuff, and that just helps me relax a bunch. Anything anything that's got either a tune or a beat, I don't discriminate.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it's funny you should say that. I was listening to an interview with Disclosure, whose album came out last week. And these are guys in their 20s who do, I mean, it's, ostensibly it's dance music, I suppose. But they were saying how people are always quite surprised when they say that they are influenced by artists, you know, from, like, 20 years ago or something. So, well, you're only 20. And they said, well, yeah, but when people are classical musicians, nobody says to them, I can't believe you're influenced by somebody who was born 300 years ago. And you're like, well, yeah. And it works the same way, doesn't it? So I suppose your influences must come from people, as you say, from, you know, more recently, but also from the greats as well.
Yeah, totally. I have my... my core singing influences, like people like Pavarotti and Mario Lanza, all those kinds of the classics, the greats. But then I listen to new stuff. I listen to stuff as it comes out, like a band I really like. They just released an album. I listened to it 4 or 5 times the first day it came out.
Yeah.
And that stuff inspires me in a very different way, but it's all kind of a similar... vibe.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, stay with us, Jonathan. Lots more to talk about. Let's get a quick update on the roads. Jonathan Antoine Volare. Are you actually performing that in the studio with us right now?
Just a little, a couple clicks along.
Do you get an urge to sing along with your songs when you hear them being played?
Weirdly, yeah. I never listen to them, but I get this strange urge to mirror myself or harmonise with myself, because you never get to do that in normal life, I guess.
No, you don't, do you? Have you fancied doing that? Doing like a Beach Boys idea behind it?
I really have, actually, because alongside that, no other classical artist has ever harmonised with themselves.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure. I've never heard it, at least.
No.
So,
what a great idea. I think that would work well, wouldn't it? I mean, because it would be the first time ever that that was happening. Maybe that could be your next album.
Patent pending.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You heard it here first. Let's talk about the tour. We're very excited to be seeing you. This is it's a full-on tour, this, for you.
Yeah.
What can we expect within that repertoire? What things have you got up your sleeve?
Well, I'm trying not to give too much away, but obviously there will be pretty much the full album, the full Tenore album, from last year, and then a whole ton of fun new things. There's going to be stuff from musicals, there's going to be adaptations of modern songs, and adaptations of slightly older sort of 60s songs, and then from way back, it's going to be an absolute mishmash of everything that I like, and hopefully everything that you like too.
Yeah.
The plan is to strip away all of these strange layers of overproduction and weirdness surrounding the performance, and just give you me with music.
Right.
And yeah, it's going to be a ton of fun. There's going to be stuff like Hushabye by Mountain, which people might not expect to be that interesting, but what we've done with it, what we've played around with, has just made it such a strangely compelling song.
Yeah. What to you makes a great song? When you're listening to music, what is it that piques your interest? What are you looking for, would you say?
That is an incredibly tough question. I try and enjoy every single genre of music.
Yeah.
So planting down one specific thing would be really, really hard. But just when a song is super well written, when it crescendos and diminuendos at the very right times, and all the notes that are purposeful and needed, and the lack of notes is purposeful and needed where it is needed.
Yeah.
It's an imprecise but extremely precise art form. Is the weirdest thing.
You can't really put your finger on it, can you?
Oh, no.
You know, you talked about Mario Lanza earlier on.
Yeah.
And I remember my parents had a copy, and I'm sure you've had it in your household for many years, of The Student Prince.
Yeah.
I think every household had one. And whenever Drink, Drink, Drink came on, I loved it. And I was only 2 or 3 years old first hearing that song. And every time I hear it now, it takes me back. It's that memory. And the song itself as well is such an up, you know, it's a give it all song. It really is. And again, you know, you're right, I can't put my finger on what it is about that song. But I would imagine that Mario Lanza is very much one of your favourites.
Oh, yeah, he's just fantastic. The way that he interprets the songs and gives a performance, as opposed to just singing a song, is second to none. Like, I don't think I've ever seen someone act so well while they sing.
Mm.
There are maybe people who you could consider technically more proficient, but in terms of the feel and what he brings across, he's unbeaten still.
Yeah, absolutely. And we were talking while we were listening to that as well about plans for future projects and all that. Are you the kind of person that plans ahead, you know, like over a year? Or do you actually stop and say, OK, tour next, then we'll think about something after the tour? Is that the way you work?
Yeah.
Is that you like to take it steady?
I try and take that second option where I let what's happening happen, and then once that has happened, I can think about whatever's next. Planning in advance generally hasn't tended to be very easy for me, because I never know exactly where I'm going to be whatever day.
Yeah.
So just taking it step by step, day by day, is the easiest way for me.
Yeah. You are one of the most calm guests I've ever had in the studio, I can't tell you that. Really, it's great. You bring so much serenity into the studio, which is always great. It really
is. Thank you very much.
And as far as the CDs, because, I mean, that's still out there and still selling, isn't it, all the
time?
Yes,
indeed. So. It's you can still buy it from any reputable retailer online or in real life.
Is it on vinyl, by the way?
It is. It had a very limited vinyl run. I'm not sure if you can actually buy them.
Yeah.
But one actually went off for auction for a charity for over £300.
Wow.
the other day, pretty much, and yeah, that blew my mind. It's a gorgeous thing, but there was some shipping errors and all sorts of craziness behind it, which meant that they're extremely, extremely limited.
Mm. Have you heard the vinyl version, then? You actually put it on a record player?
I have copies, but I haven't even dared to get them out of the shrink wrap. Just because maybe if like there's five left in the world one day,
yeah,
that maybe someone will really, really want those.
Yeah, absolutely. Because we have a show here at BBC Essex between 12 and 2 every Sunday. Mark Punter plays vinyl, nothing but vinyl, and counts down the vinyl chart. And I thought, isn't it interesting now that we're going back to vinyl again?
Yeah, I mean...
It's great.
I have a little vinyl collection myself for a few years now, so... I'm totally behind it. There's a certain je ne sais quoi about the sound of a vinyl.
Yeah, there is, isn't there?
Yeah.
There is something about it. It's like when it skips, it's no bad thing. It's almost like it makes it real.
The little pops and the cracks and the hissing, all the little defects, they were kind of meant to be in there in some cases.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Now, as far as the tour is concerned, let's just talk about some of the places we're playing. Now, I am absolutely aware that if Twitter's anything to go by, there are people listening all over the world at the moment, in Florida, in Australia, in New Zealand,
hello, in Japan.
Hello to everybody. And so obviously this is just a UK tour for now, isn't it? Are there any plans to spread your wings across the water at all?
It's a tough one to really say, because you can make plans and then it can just never come to fruition.
Yeah.
It's very tricky to say about going over any pond, really, but I'd really, really like to. Someone come and sponsor me, please!
Yeah, sponsor Jonathan, he'll come over your place. That's fair enough.
I'd love to.
Do these one-to-one concerts then, couldn't you? No, not a problem at all. So, locally to us, I think London is the closest, isn't it?
Yes, indeed. The Tabernacle in Notting Hill.
Right. And what's the date on that?
I believe that... Oh, my goodness, is the 12th, the 12th
the
of November.
There we are,
Terrible with dates, terrible with names, terrible with places.
I noticed you playing the City Varieties in Leeds
as well.
I actually played there. I did Lock Up Your Daughters. I was Old Faithful in Lock Up Your Daughters in 1986. It's a lovely little theatre. They did the good old days there, didn't they, on BBC Telly. So there's an awful lot of ghosts in there. You can feel in a good way.
Yeah.
You know, the spirits of old performers.
Oh, that's really cool.
So
yeah, I'm excited for that.
Fantastic.
Amazing.
The stage in Gateshead, by the way, if you're listening to Castleway, Birmingham, the Bramall Music Hall, the Atkinson in Southport, and the Lowry in Salford. Why not? Let's do them all.
Why not?
We've got them all in there. I think we pretty much have, haven't we?
Most of them. I think there's. In Cardiff, Millennium Centre, Royal Hippodrome Theatre, Eastbourne, Lowther Pavilion in Lytham, which is the very first one, and did you do Southport?
I did do Southport, didn't I? Yes, I did. Yeah,
Salford, which is the final date, the Lowry. Yeah, I think that is all of them.
Wow, that's amazing. It's no wonder you like to relax.
I mean,
one gig at a time.
Yeah, thankfully there's spaces between most of these gigs.
Yeah.
So I do get time to just recollect myself after giving it all, which is definitely what I like to do. I'd like to give every single part of myself in the performance.
Well, I'm sure we shall see it all. Believe, the latest tour by Jonathan Antoine. Absolute pleasure having you in, mate. Thank
pleasure
you so
to be
much.
Here.
And come and see us when you've recovered from the tour.
Yes,
you've had a good lie down. You come back in.
Sometime around Christmas. Yes, indeed.
Look forward to it. Take care. Thanks again, mate.
Thank you.
Jonathan Antoine live on the show this afternoon here at BBC Essex. Always great to see him, and his latest album out now too. In